This episode is a shout out to the lovely intuitive training going on. That is where real teaching is happening because we love our dogs. In this episode of Learning About Dogs podcast, Kay Lawrence and Sue McGuire discuss advocating again for the needs of the dogs and why we, Kay and I, are not like the others.
Okay, so I was watching TV series as one of our national rehoming centers, and there was a bunch of them being videoed taking the dogs for a walk. A group of kennel staff, or you know, staff on the site, probably about 12 of them, one dog each. Every single dog was walking in front of them at the end of the lead. Were they pulling? Didn't matter. Mm-mm. Nobody was struggling. No dog was what I call pavement swimming, you know, gagging against the collar. They were all on harnesses and they all had good contact. You know, there was no must walk on a loose leaf by the side of the person. You know, nope, they were just out there. And it was, to me, I looked at it and I thought, goodness me, they're taking those dogs out for the dog's benefit. And it wasn't about exercise. It was about the dogs having this large treed area where they could sniff and walk, and the folk were chatting as they went along. And it was just looked like that's what it should be. Mm-hmm. That's what it should be.
Absolutely.
Not this must walk but next to me, must walk on a loose leash, because if it's not a loose leash, it's a disobedient dog, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Whew. No, it was about sniffing, about engaging. And they were walking far enough away from each other that the dogs would not have got wrapped up on these leads at all.
Sure.
No, it was not. And it was, I thought, goodness me, that's refreshing to see.
I used to always tell people when I was working at sheltering that of the volunteers that I had, for the previous generations of me, it was like, we must train the volunteers to do this right. And yeah, I used to laugh because I thought, oh, intuitively they know how to do this right, because their passion, they're volunteers for criminy's sakes.
Where is their passion
but for the animals? So yeah. You know, I would go out and watch them, and it's, oh my gosh, so intuitive. What? Oh, you want to sniff that? You want to look at that? Fabulous. Yeah, you want to go dig for a gopher? Fabulous.
Yeah, because this is about you coming out of prison for an hour or two, having the best possible time I can give you.
Yes. Yes.
You know, there's a borderline to which you've got to go up to with indulgence,
sure,
building habits that were going to be hard to change away. But under those conditions, that 1 hour out, yeah, I'd want it to be precious and the best it could be.
Yeah. And guess what? That's not going to help them get adopted, whether or not they do that.
Yeah.
What's going to get them is how they look, believe it or not.
Well, it did go through the whole phase of, if you train the dog to as many tricks as possible, that makes it more appealing.
Yeah.
But, you know, the tricks were always done for the trainer, not for the actual people who came to look around.
Yeah.
As you say, and it's what they looked like, because that's what we were sold on. You know, the books that were out 20, 30 years ago, when you look through them, how to choose the type of dog for you, it would show you pictures. It would tell you how much coat needed doing. It would tell you what colours they come in, what size they were, and it was all measured on looks. Yeah, you know, I mean, even the Gordon Setters, I mean, 20 years since I had a litter of puppies, but people came and had one because they'd already had a red one and they fancied a black and tan one.
Okay.
Nothing to do with how different they were from the Irish Setters at all, you know, like, okay, I think maybe not for you.
Because
it's all about what it looked like.
Yeah. So I guess I sort of feel like defeated at times, but at the same time, just keep plug through.
Yeah, because it's you know, sort of kudos. Well, there are people out there that think like us, and they're struggling to find a way forwards as well. Yeah. And if they could, they would. Yeah, and if we can give them the rich resources that are at our fingertips, that in everything we do, the diet, the exercise, the way the dogs live, you know, the fact we don't have to do this with them or that with them, or that, you know, the other thing with them, because we're all about letting them live the best life they can, not at any expense to anybody, but of benefit to that dog. Yes, it is out there. It's a resource that people can find if they look for it. And we need to build this resource broad and wide.
Yes. I want to encourage people, because I came to this point where I felt like I'm not having fun. It's not for me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so then the companion to that is looking for things that are for you. I have to, frankly, my own personal journey, I'll talk about me for a second. My own personal journey has been, oh my gosh, it's actually quite simple. when you find out that, oh, that's not for me, that's not for me. Oh, what is for me is really kind of fun.
It's asking
who they are. Asking.
Well, it's the whole thing that, you know, you get to the point where you think there are only square holes and I'm a round peg. So, damn, I'm going to have to adapt myself to fit in a square hole because right. I can't find any round ones. And we're saying, no, there are many round ones out there, but they might not shout quite as loudly as the square ones. Yeah. And you feel that, oh, I've got to adapt and do it the same as everybody else. Yes. And I just quietly went my own way and go, no, I don't want to do that with my dog. And I remember this Abacab, it was, that was the very hot dog on the trials. He actually took the sheep once back to the holding pen at the top of the field. Totally got disorientated halfway down. And we went back up the field. I'm like, even though I'm whistling him to come back to me, the echo around the whole bloody place was bad. And he took the sheep straight back up to the top into the holding pen. The guy had to get him to jump in the car and bring him back to me. Anyway, that sort of dog, they remember him. I remember he went out and did a competition in obedience, and the send away that we have to send the dog out to and drop the dog and then do a recall to heel, blah, blah, blah. He started to try and pick up the actual box that the dog had laid down in because it was like a toy box thing. And as I'm walking away from him, I could see the people watching all laughing and pointing because there he was coming up behind me with this rattling thing. And I'm like, oh, what have you done, naughty boy? And the judge said, well, I'll look away if you want to get onto him and make him stay out there. So the judge was going to just pretend he didn't see me correct the dog and put him back. And I said, no, it's okay. I'll just call it a day at that. Thanks very much. You know, yeah, but everybody was there wanting to tell me because, yeah, no, she needs some help with this dog. How to sort him out. And it was like, wow.
Come and train with us. Links to the courses and other offerings are in the episode notes. Thanks for listening. Give me a key.